Today I have Sueanne from Trinidad to talk about a topic that is fairly new for people because it is engaging the grieving process with technology and perhaps even this whole lockdown experience. Hello, Sueanne. How are you today?
Hi, David. I'm good. Thank you very much.
Ooh, that's an interesting shift of energy, and I apologize. It seems to be a little bit what's going on for a lot of people. It's sort of this roller coaster that sometimes the highs go high and the lows go low, and I think I'm embodying that today with parts of my day, and I have a feeling you've had a little bit of that going on in your day.
Yes, today was a day of mixed emotions, some vexations and some indifference, some detachment, but mostly irritation. And so with this whole COVID pandemic that has happened, what has made me consciously aware is how fluid everything is, how time is really a gift, and the isolation that we are all experiencing, even for those of us who are of sound, or who are not impacted by mental health issues or anything like that, are now feeling the impact of it in a way that I don't think that we anticipated we were going to feel it. So when I got the news that my cousin had passed, it hit because she's pretty much in the same age group as a lot of the cousins. So I, myself, my brother, my sister are part of the older sets of cousins in the family on both sides, both my mother's side and my dad's side of the family. This particular, we call her cousin, but she is the goddaughter to my dad and was very close to my dad. And she's known to have a very lively personality, and she's known to always be smiling, always has her door open. So whenever you went to visit her, her door was always open. And when she hugged you. Like, you could feel her energy, you can feel her love. So with the online funeral, number one, keep in mind there are two generations here, which was quite so my mom, for example, is not familiar with Zoom technology. So she was calling me to figure out how to get onto the Zoom. At one point she was afraid that she couldn't get on, and I said to her, no, keep trying. Eventually she did get on, and she texted me back saying yes, she got on. But then, just like what we went through just a few minutes ago, she couldn't figure out the audio. So she called me again, and I'm showing her, telling her, okay, do you see a mic on your screen at the bottom left? And she's like, yeah, okay. Click on the arrow and adjust your speaker or your microphone. And that got her to work. So you have two generations, one generation, the older generation, who are not too familiar on how to use Zoom, and I'm teaching. And then you have the younger generation, which are her nieces and nephews, grandchildren, who are totally comfortable in technology and have no issues navigating it. So everybody in the chat window was like, well, what do I do here? What do I do here? And so everybody's like, you know, chiming in, okay, do this, do that, do that. So part of this is people are learning how to use and adapt to the technology, the new technology, where they never had to before. And so the other part of it is seeing each other visually. That took away some of the fear of the isolation. And so when you saw the familiar faces on the gallery board, it was like, okay, you know, yes, we're not physically there inside of a funeral ward or a church, but yet we were there. And seeing the expressions on everyone's face, some were hurting a little bit more than others. Some were still in a state of disbelief. And some were still in a state of, you can see it in their eyes that they weren't quite ready to accept that she has passed. So it's given me a sense of immortality. But yet, we know that the spirit lives. And so physically, she may not be here, but her spirit lives. So I've said my prayers, and I've released her spirit, and wherever her spirit is right now, pray that she's just having a party, true to her nature, because she loved to dance, she loved to laugh.
Actually, I was going to interrupt you earlier, yet I felt your energy was very relevant for what you're experiencing right now. Yet, I want to step back when you found out you couldn't go, because you're the type of person that would have got on a plane and been in Florida. You would have flown from Toronto. You would have wanted to pay your respects. It's something that you've probably done most of your life. And so when you found out about the passing and you found out you couldn't go, what did that trigger in you?
A real deep sadness. I remember when my mom told me the news, I just felt all the air come out of me, out of my lungs. And it was like the words couldn't come out because I had to absorb what she had just said to me. But as soon as she said it, I remember saying a prayer. And then I said, oh my goodness. And she's like, what? I said, nobody can be there to say goodbye. Nobody can really have closure. And even though we did this, I don't feel it's going to be closure for some of the relatives. Not in the traditional way for some of the relatives. So I feel that this will not be easy for the relatives who want and need that traditional way of, you know, going up and praying with the body during a wake, or holding the hand of the body and saying their goodbyes. So, but for me, when I heard the news, there was just a deep, deep sadness, because it was like, we can't be there.
So it beckons the question, given that some of the relatives might be finding it difficult, or there might other be people that are finding that right now, when we can't be with our beloveds, when they pass over the COVID-19, if you're in a hospital, you die alone. You could be married to someone for 60 years, but if they're in the hospital, you can't even go see them. Would there be one or two things that you might be able to share with them to serve or assist or to make a difference in their journey?
So for those who are in a hospital and cannot see a relative, I would say the most important thing would be to share your love in whichever way, express your love in whichever way you can. So if the hospital staff can set up some sort of, like what we're doing here, a Zoom call or something through the phone or whatever they can do, give them that ability to, even if they're semi-conscious in the hospital, the brain still can allow the body to hear. So allowing them to hear you setting your prayers and your love, I think would help and give that subconscious encouragement for the person who's ill in the hospital. The other part of it I feel is because when you're in a hospital and you're alone, whether you're ill or you're recovering, there is this fear, and the fear is usually from a place of not wanting to feel lonely, not necessarily alone. So even if it's just a phone call to that person who's in the hospital room and them hearing your voice in some way or another, it's likely to lift their spirits.
All right, I got to shift a little bit of the energy, all right? Because you know that my dad was in the hospital with a broken femur last month, and my mom had 12 days without him. The last 3 or 4 days, my sister introduced my dad and my mom to WhatsApp, and they started having these video calls. And the last 4 days my dad was in the hospital, he was calling my mom from like 5 in the morning to 11 at night, like about 5 times. I actually had to intervene and say, what are you guys, teenagers or what? And they've been married 62 years. Yet you're absolutely right about if you give people a device or an opportunity, a newness, they might be able to rekindle or establish a bit of joy and happiness and even a little comedy or fun into the experience. And that's what happened, honestly. That was my experience with my mom and my dad. And then I played along because I was teasing my mom a little bit. It's like, you guys are like teenagers talking for like hours on the phone. Like, what is all this going on? And she actually thought it was pretty cute. And I think it actually helped when he did come back home, and that they found a little bit more playfulness in their dynamic as opposed to perhaps the seriousness of it.
Mm-hmm.
And so
part of it is just, well, you said 60 years. So there's a familiarity between the two of them that they're missing. There's the physical presence that they have between the two of them. And so for both of them, they were probably feeling, well, I know this individual is always there, but they're not there. So that other part of them is definitely the absence of that other person is really there for them. And so that yearning to hear the voice is even that much more greater. So when you go back to this online funeral now, there's the physical presence of that person is no longer there. So that yearning of wanting to hear them, touch them, and see them again is something that stays with your memory. And so, for example, they were showing pictures of her, and there was a picture where she was on a motorcycle because her husband rides a motorcycle. And I remember when I was down there 1 year, her husband turned to me. I saw the motorcycle, and I'm like, you ride motorcycles? And he's like, yeah. And I looked at her, I'm like, you too? And she's like, no, I usually ride behind. So I'm like, and he could see it on my face, and he's like, you want to go for a ride, don't you? I'm like, yes. And so he gave me the helmet and stuff, and we got on the motorcycle, and he took me around. And he's like, how you doing back there, Sueanne? And I'm like, I'm good. And he's like, I can tell you want to go faster, don't you? And I'm like, yes. And he just booted it. And I was like in my element. I was like, oh my gosh, this is so amazing. And then I said to him, but wait a minute. I've got a helmet on. Why don't you have a helmet on? He's like, oh, the laws here are really lax, so don't worry. And I'm like, but we're going pretty fast. I think I should worry. But he was good. He navigated. And when we came back to the house, and she was waiting for me there with a drink and everything, and she said, how was it? And I was like, oh my gosh, it was so awesome. And she's like, oh, you're brave. And I'm like, what do you mean? And she's like, well, I don't really go out as much with him on the motorcycle. I'm like, oh my gosh, I've had such an adrenaline rush. This was such an amazing. So when I saw that picture, that memory, it just hit me right away. And the laughs that we had afterwards, sitting in the garage, just chatting away, it was just like, I was right there. So it's little things like that. So, I guess what I want to say is, even though we are not physically there with her, the memories we have allow us to be there with her.
I just typed in the message, and it's this idea of celebrate the experiences, honor the experiences, laugh with the memories is probably one of the greatest things you can do when you're afar. I also am aware that you're into your prayer, and maybe you even were able to see her or experience her in her next realm. And is there something that you might want to share with our listeners today on assisting them to connect, to communicate, to celebrate the experience of knowing this beloved person and still having them as part of your life?
I would say pretty much what you had just shared. It's celebrating that memory, because really, that's what's going to keep the smile on your face when you think about it. As you're praying for her spirit and sending her spirit, I would just say, allow her spirit to be free. Give her spirit the peace that it needs to dance, to sing, to laugh, and wherever that journey is going to take her. You know, just know that the time and the joy that she gave us was special. So I guess what I'm learning as I see relatives pass and so forth, and as I lose other, you know, older elders in the family, as much as you want to remember them as they are, you just have to trust that wherever their spirit is, it's a better place.
That's a nice bringing it together. And I guess I'd love you to own it a little bit more, and because you're almost talking, telling people to trust it. What about your message to yourself? Is it a faith? Is it a trust? Is it a seeing? Is it a feeling? That do you know that she's in a better place? Are you can see her, feel her, experience her? Or
it's still too early. It's a feeling, but it's still too early. I know some people say they will dream their relatives, and some say they can feel their relative. Some people say that you know, something happened that told them that their relative was there with them. It's still early for me. So I have to process it and give it that time as well. And I guess with time, knowing how I feel right now, it will be a release. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for sharing. It's delving into a experience that is truly your experience. And I guess if I was asked one more little question, is as it may assist you in the process, is what prayer or what guidance or what invitation would you have for people that might be going through the process where they're not able to physically be with a beloved, their family member might be far away, they're in lockdown, yet they still want to express the love, compassion to themselves and to the family members that might be mourning or grieving?
The easiest way is to write a letter to yourself. And in that letter say, you know, dear love letter or dear letter, this is what I want to share today for my aunt, my grandmother, my friend, my cousin, my sister, my girlfriend. So by writing the letter, it will allow you to release some of the emotions that you weren't able to share with that individual, with the time that you had with her. The other piece I feel is because of the distance, is to talk to a relative and share those experiences with the relative. So for example, after the online funeral, my mom called her sister, and they had a deeper conversation. And because really one of the things about this whole online funeral too, there is an element of impersonal and we're so connected as individuals and as families and communities, and this is just making us realize how much we really need and want those connections. And so really the key piece here is not to mourn alone. Reach out to the relatives that you're comfortable with and have those conversations, whether it's by phone, whether it's like what we're doing here today, a Zoom call, whether it's by WhatsApp or FaceTime. Have those conversations. You need a way to release some of those emotions. And as you're releasing those emotions, laugh and cry at the same time and enjoy the laugh and the crying at the same time. And be comfortable with the laughing and the crying at the same time. And because that's going to bridge some of that distancing that you may feel. This social distancing is very uncomfortable. And so in a funeral setting like this, you know, like people pass away in all different situations and so forth. But when it's a family, you know, we rely on the traditions of honoring our loved ones when they pass on. So we're not getting the memory of the traditional funeral. So we're creating a different type of memory for the funeral. So I guess what I'm saying is still have those conversations. Reach out to whoever you can. Write out your emotions in a letter, and as if you're going to send that letter to the person that you've lost. But also keeping in mind with this whole new technology world that we're living in, don't allow the coldness of it, and don't allow the impersonality of it prevent you from reaching out and sharing those feelings that you might be having.
Thank you so much. And I really appreciate your insights. And I will have a little spin on this idea that the connection we can have using this technology is amazing. If you start to use your prayers, if you start to use your third eye, the reality sometimes in our altered states can be more real than this conversation, can be more real than actually seeing the person in person, because this incredible ability to connect with people anywhere through prayer, through third eye, is also an amazing skill that can be developed. So I invite you, I invite our listeners to work, develop, to play with it, because it truly can be amazing, this multidimensional way of loving, expressing honor, expressing compassion. And so with that, if there's another word you want to share, I welcome one more word. If not, I'll bring this session to close.
No, I would just say, smile through the tears. That's really it.
It's beautiful. When you get tears, actually, you start to see rainbows. And if you start to see rainbows, you might believe in miracles. And if you believe in miracles, life becomes a miracle. Thank you so much, Sueanne. Appreciate your time, your energy, and your message. Namaste.
Thank you. Namaste.